welcome. First things first, there are speaker evaluations as well as some handouts in front of you. We would greatly appreciate it if you take the time, even if we're terrible over the next sort of 90 minutes, to give us some honest feedback. It's how the Public Alliance brings us speakers back. It's also how we learn as speakers to bring you better material. Or if you can say we're brilliant, we really appreciate those comments too. So welcome to Digital Marketing 101 for Charter Schools. First things first, we're big fans of why, so we wanted to start with why you should spend the next sort of 60 minutes with us listening about these tips. We've got a little video to show you that we think really sums up why this topic is important, not only for us as individuals, but as school leaders too. So take a listen. By the good folks at Google, and I think it sums up why this topic is so important, because much like all of those buying decisions and those decision-making process that anybody is having in moments of how do I find some solution to a problem, the same thing is happening in the education space when parents or a student or somebody that's around a student is looking for a better educational choice, and when they, more often than not, almost 80% of education decisions start online these days. More often than not, they're going to Google, they're going on social media, they're finding either schools or places that can offer them a different educational perspective. And if you're not there, if you're not online, then you have no ability to be found as a school and able to tell your story in a really compelling way. So that's why this kind of encapsulates why we think it's really important that charters have these knowledge so that you can be there in those moments when either a parent or a student is looking for a better place to be educated or a different place to be educated. So, we're going to do some introductions, starting with Kim.
Hi. How's everybody? Good. Or the after-lunch session. I'm Kim Frazier. I am VP of Marketing with an organization called Charter School Capital. We work with charter schools around the country. We're a specialty finance organization, but we do much more than that. My role in marketing is to work with schools and also to help market what we do within the charter school movement. Prior to being with Charter School Capital, I've been here about 5 years now, I ran a branding and marketing agency in Portland, Oregon for 15 years. So I am well steeped in marketing, and I know both of these gentlemen through my agency time.
Hi, Scott Kaufman. I'm a partner with a digital marketing firm called Lucid Agency, and we actually do digital marketing. We work with Kim and Michael on a lot of different projects. So hope you guys get a lot from the presentation. I think you'll get some valuable stuff from it.
And I'm Michael Barber. I run a small agency in Los Angeles called Barber & Hewitt. Why am I sitting here? I've worked with Kim on the charter school account for the last 5 years. And I sit on two boards in LA, two charter school boards, helping them with student enrollment engagement activities, like some of the tactics that you're going to see today. So I've got a little bit of experience in helping schools with this. And I know Scott's team actually works with a couple of schools in Phoenix as well, where they are based. So that's us. So that's why you got to listen to us for the next 60 or so minutes. Also, just so you're aware, we are live streaming this on Facebook, on Charter School Capital's Facebook page, so the session's being recorded. So if you're furiously taking notes, you don't have to, you can just pay attention. And this video will be embedded on a website that we'll show you in just a second, where you can go either share it with somebody else that's at your school or a part of your organization, or you can watch it on the plane home, or you know, it's highly entertaining, I'm sure, by the end of the 60 minutes, so you're gonna wanna watch it again and again and again. But just so you're aware, we are live, so understand that things are being recorded. What are we gonna talk about over the next 60 minutes? We're gonna give you sort of an overview and a definition of what digital means to us and what it should mean to schools. We're gonna go through some of the best tactics that we think schools should engage on, from email to social, search marketing, things of that nature. We've also included a couple slides at the bottom as sort of an appendix on this deck that are additional tactics that you can think about as a school. We've done this session at the Ohio Conference, we did a form of it for National last year, we've done it in California a number of times, and it's evolved. What we know is that we always end up fielding a ton of questions, and we would rather answer those questions than bore you with just slides and text, because that's obviously more informative for you. So we've trimmed it down to the core real tactics, the digital marketing tactics that we thought would be really beneficial. But there's a slew of other opportunities that you can take advantage of if you've got the budget, the time, or the resources to be able to do that. And so we wanted to include all of those items as well as sort of an appendix. So you've got those additional slides that will be available at that website that's at the bottom there. We'll finish with just a few resources if you're kind of a lifelong learner, if you've got a communications team that's a part of your school, giving them a series of links and places that they can go to learn more and find some of the latest and greatest on any of these tactics. And then sort of final thoughts, where to start and budget for these types of tactics and what you can expect to spend when you're either at year zero, as you're maturing, and sort of getting that sustaining model 5 or 10 years down the line. And then all the slides and the video recording that we're doing for Facebook will be up at that website, charterschoolcapital.org/national. We'll have them up probably, 20 to 30 minutes after the session, and you can go there and download the slides. Feel free to take them and use them at your disposal, or also watch the video again in case any of this feels a bit confusing. Also, you've got all of Kim, Scott, and Mai's contact information on that first slide as well as on the last slide of this deck. Please feel free to email us, shoot us a question, call us, text us. If something doesn't make sense and you don't want to ask the question, we're more than happy to get back to you over the coming days if you have additional questions after this session. So that's what you can expect over the next few minutes. So we're going to start with this. What is digital marketing? And I'm going to turn this over. Actually, Kim's got some questions. We wanted to get a read of the room. So.
Yes. So how many folks here are school leaders at independent charters?
Most of you.
How about with the CMO or network of schools? Authorizers? A few? Okay. Great. And how many of you are currently executing marketing programs internally with internal staff?
Externally with partners.
Okay. Good, that's awesome. Good. Great, so we're gonna talk a little bit about what is digital marketing. So there's a lot of ways to define what digital marketing is. You know, back in the day when it was the new term digital marketing, it meant very concise. So there weren't very many activities that people were doing around the digital space, but now it's very broad. And we're going to talk about some of those things today. But the key element here is to think about what you're trying to communicate, what's the message that you need to get across, the platform by which you're getting that message through, and who the audience is. So, for example, we're going to talk about some search engine marketing, we're going to talk about email marketing. There are different tools to use for different reasons. And it depends on the message you're trying to get out, and it also depends on the audience you're trying to reach. So if you're trying to reach everybody with everything, with all the tools that are out there, you're probably wasting your time. You really want to focus on the audience you're trying to reach, and then think about the tools and then the message and which tool, best tool to use to get that message out there. And we'll spend some more time talking about that. There's a lot of things that you can use digital marketing for, right? You need to think about digital marketing as a piece of what you're doing overall. There are a lot of reasons why we focus on digital marketing in these sessions that we give, because there are a lot of things that schools can do that are easy to deploy for organizations that have very small marketing teams. A a lot of schools only have a person, and it may not even be a dedicated marketing person. It's someone who's been tasked with doing the marketing. So, you know, yes, there are a lot of things that you can do in the marketing realm, but we like to focus on digital because it's something that can be done fairly easily with a minimal staff. So, we can go next.
I'll also say, just out on the Kim, is just because I think National has put a priority on some of these newer tactics, that's not to say that I don't think you should think about some of the older tried and true or traditional tactics as well. We've worked with charters that are in markets that don't, for whatever reason, when the target audience is wrong, the type of audience that you're going after just doesn't fit well from a digital perspective, right? They don't have smartphones at their disposal. They are a different type of audience, right? So just because we're playing in placing an emphasis on this particular, these particular type of tactics over the next hour or so, doesn't mean that the traditional things like flyers and posters and radio ads and billboards couldn't work well for your school or the market where you may be expanding into. I think, you know, one of the takeaways in Kim's talk that a little bit is about getting a better understanding of your audience. Digital tactics could be really beneficial for those types of audiences, but there's going to be audiences where these tactics don't work well at all, where the sort of tried and true old school marketing tactics still work well these days, and we see that all the time. More and more, we're starting to see schools leverage a mix of both, and those tend to be sort of the sweet spots for them. How much budget they're allocating either way really depends on the market, but they're doing a healthy mix of both what we would call offline tactics, like newspaper ads, direct mail, radio ads, on-site radio engagements, things of that nature, as well as layering on some of the digital marketing techniques as well.
So one of the things that we like to talk about when we're talking about a digital presence or digital programs is backing up a little bit and thinking at a higher level. And we talk about your brand. So how many of the organizations that are here have actually gone through an exercise to clearly define your brand or your differentiation in your market? A few of you have. Okay, that's good. So it's really important. So if you haven't done that, I would suggest that be an exercise that you do, and it doesn't have to be very complicated. You wanna really get to the essence of what your school is about. So what makes your school and your program unique? We've seen in many cases with schools around the country that they're very passionate, really excited about the programs that they have to offer in to the community that they're located, but they haven't necessarily articulated what that's about. It's like, this is so great, we're really excited, we've got this new program, but what is so unique about it that a family and a student is gonna wanna come to your school over some of the other choices that are out there? And given that there are a lot of choices out there, that's really important, because if you just go out and you're another program that is like other schools in your community, it's gonna be really hard for a parent to say, well, why should I send my student to this school over school A or B or C? So getting to that question of what makes your school unique, what makes your program unique, and take a little time to write out what all those reasons are, that'll be really helpful in defining what your brand is. And get to the essence of what your school is about, right? So you're unique, what defines that uniqueness, and what is the essence of who you are? Why did you start the school in the first place? What is it that you're trying to offer? And really clearly define that. And that's how you get to what we call a brand promise. What are you promising to the families and the students that will enroll in your program? What are you promising that they're going to get when they go through the school and the program and they graduate and go on to, you know, whether it's high school or another school? What are they going to leave with? And that really gets to the brand promise that you're going to deliver. What are you trying to accomplish? What's the goal for the charter school? Right? Are you looking at enrollment? Are you trying to increase the enrollment? Are you trying to create awareness within the community about your program? Are you looking at communicating messaging so that you can get a new facility? It could be all of the above, but there are different ways that you want to talk about your program in these different instances, and really having a goal of what you're trying to accomplish is going to help when you dive into the types of programs that we're going to talk about a little bit later. And then being strategic, right? We talked a little bit earlier about audiences. How many of you have actually sat down and mapped out the audiences that you're trying to reach? A few. That's good. Yeah, it's really important. And you know, again, it doesn't have to be something that's super complex, but if you just take a little bit of time to think through all of the audiences that you want to reach, and, you know, students, obviously, parents, yes, community, but think outside that, who are the influencers that help families make the decisions of where they're going to send their child to school? And you will likely come up with a short list of those that you may not realize you're not communicating with, and you add those into who you're trying to reach. Budget, obviously, is something you need to consider. How much budget are you going to allocate to the programs that you want to execute? And one thing that we've seen is that school leaders really want to dive in and do some of this work, but you really have to look at what can we be successful at executing. You don't have to dive in and execute everything all at once. So budget and goals go hand in hand. Are you going to execute things internally with internal staff, or are you going to hire somebody, or are you going to use outside resources? And then measuring results. So you can do all this great work, and if you haven't set your goals and looked at how you're going to measure those results, then you may have wasted some of your time.
So once you've defined that story, how do you bring it to life with digital tactics? As I mentioned before, we're going to sort of go through some of those core tactics that we think are really sort of the 101 level. And again, we've got tactics that you can take additionally that are in this in the appendix of this deck as well. So we're going to touch on bringing that brand to life online through a core asset that you own as a school, which is your website. What do you need that website to do? What should the questions you should be asking when you're thinking about either starting that website for a year zero school or redesigning that website if you're going through that process? We're going to talk about search engine optimization and how you go about optimizing your site. Scott's going to take you through some really key tactics and tools. We're also going to talk about a paid version of that, or pay-per-click advertising, or PPC as well. We'll get into a little bit on social media and how you can tell your story through a variety of the ever more popular social media platforms, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat, and the like. Email marketing, sort of one of the old tried and true old tactics, is still something that you're seeing a ton of engagement from schools leveraging, and the ability for them to target and tell different stories through that channel to different types of audiences, whether it's their authorizer or if it's political organizations or students and parents alike. Touch a little bit on video. 86% of what people will consume by 2020 on their smartphones will be video-based. So this is a really important tactic and something that you should be considering. How do we execute video? How do we produce video? How do we get assets, video assets from our schools and produce something that tells our story visually? So something to really pay attention to. And then the last two are the two that we'll put in the appendix, which are display advertising. We're talking about banner advertising, and then retargeting, which is when someone comes to your website and then targeting them again with ads later on. If we get through all the material, which I promise we probably won't once you start asking questions, then we can touch on those things at the end, but the slides are there with the tools and the tactics related to those particular channels as well.
So one of the things to think about as we move it through talking to these different tactics that are here is to think about how they fit into where you are in terms of your stage of growth. Right, so some of these tactics are going to work really well if you're in a startup phase. So, you know, year zero, have my charter, till you're year about two. And then the needs likely will change between year two and year five. So some of these other tactics you may want to bolt on to what you have started from your startup phase. And then once you are at what we call a sustainable mature or mature school, somewhere in that 7 to 10 year range, then, you know, a lot of these tactics probably will be working in combination with one another as you're moving on, whether you're going to maintain the level you're at or you're going to begin replicating new schools.
Okay, so let's start with your home base. With any of these tactics, you're trying to send people to probably a location, whether that's your website, which we're going to talk to, or a variety of different places. You need to have a core, solid home base that you own, or your website, that's delivered in a way that works well, primarily for its biggest audience, which is not students, parents, or anybody else. It's Google. Google is your biggest audience when it comes to how should we leverage, design, and work around our website strategy. Largely because they're the people that are going to determine if that website is going to be successful. So what can we do to make sure that our websites are working well for Google? So let's start down that path. So some key things that you're going to want to think about as it relates to your site are two things. Is your site responsive? Because it was, what date? April of 2015 when Google rolled out the panda changes?
A year and a half ago.
Google said, we want websites to be responsive, meaning that they respond to the size of screen that they are being viewed in. In other words, regardless if someone's looking at a laptop or a smartphone, they can consume the content that
that's on that website. So if you are still, if you still have your school website on some old platform and it looks terrible in a smartphone or a tablet, then you are probably being dinged by Google from a search engine results perspective, because they want the ability to serve the best experience when someone clicks on a link from google.com. The other thing that they're starting to weigh heavily is how fast your site is, largely because they want people to be able to see that content as quickly as possible. And one of the things that we largely see on school-based websites is that you're on probably like the $5.99 plan with GoDaddy. Well, that just doesn't cut it these days. So making sure that you've got a site that loads quickly, that sits on a fast server, that is not the $5.99 GoDaddy plan, we're going to give you a tool where you can actually test your website to see how fast it is. And also gives you some recommendations from Google itself on what you can do to make your website better. Anything to add?
No.
Okay. Some website platforms to consider if you are year zero or if you're thinking about a full redesign. A couple of ones that we have seen schools deploy, we've also worked with schools on, that you can think about, Squarespace being one of them. If you listen to NPR or any podcast, you've probably heard of Squarespace. Really sort of easy, what you see is what you get, sort of Word style editor interface. You can utilize one of their templates or customize that template and work with a designer or a third party to build out something that looks really great and on brand for your school. But very simple to use, a monthly plan or a yearly investment, depending upon how you want to structure the costs, but not terribly too expensive. Another one that's similar like that is Wix.com. They also have, you know, a variety of different templates that you can use, that you can customize and make it really easy for anyone that has zero technical knowledge to be able to execute and deploy your website. Some that will require a little bit more of a lift, WordPress being one of them. WordPress is what's called a content management system. That's basically a fancy way of saying you can go into the back end, log in, and edit anything that you would like so that you can change titles and push up blog posts and add images to the site without needing a developer or somebody with technical knowledge. WordPress has tons of free templates out there that you can utilize, but as you're thinking about how do you tell that story and bring your brand colors to life and your brand images to life, you can also work with a ton of developers or agencies, including Scott's, on designing a site that leverages any one of these platforms so that you can take advantage of the features that those platforms has, as well as design something that's specific to your school and to your school's brand. The last one in here is Edleo. There are some more sort of full service platforms that are more positioned for the education marketplace that I believe are a sponsor of the conference. I'm not plugging them for that reason. I'm just saying there are other options out there that are specific to either the charter or the educational space that you can leverage, that also have things like attendance reporting on the back end, school engagement, things of that nature that sort of build in the website as a part of an additional feature. Those are other options you can consider as well. Okay, so some important questions to ask as you're going through this website process, whether you're starting or you're considering a redesign. The first of them, which is design. What does the layout look like? How are you using text and fonts? You'll be surprised, given how bad our eyes are these days and the smaller screens that we've got. People expect nice, beautiful, big images and nice, beautiful fonts. So consider making those fonts bigger and more resilient for the human eye, which is getting a lot weaker these days. How are you incorporating visuals, right? How are we leveraging video that we've created, or how are we leveraging images that have been taken of the school so that people can, you know, take advantage of these really nice, expensive smartphones that we all have in our pockets to bring that brand to life. Innovation, does the website look like a template, or have you fully customized it and made it something that's related to your brand? So any one of those platforms that we just mentioned has templates that are all built into them that you can just change the colors, change the fonts, and it may look like, you know, kind of you took some time. Those are more of a template structure, and they certainly make it a lot cheaper and a lot faster to execute a website. But if you really care about bringing that brand to life, from a colors perspective, from a text perspective, from how does it feel from an emotional perspective when people get on your website, then ensuring that you're using something that's been designed by a professional designer is something you're going to want to consider investing in, so that the site looks as if it was built around your brand and the conversation that you would like to have around that brand. Is it really conveying the uniqueness of the organization, right? So, you know, if you have a school that is, you know, more has a fun-loving brand, then are you bringing that sort of brand essence to life? Or if it's much more structured and scientific and math-oriented, are you bringing that feel to the website as an important component? Content. So it used to be, you know, let's say 5 or 10 years ago, it was a set-it-and-forget-it thing, right? You put up your website, maybe you made changes once every couple of months, if not maybe even less frequently than that, like once a year or something, or when someone finally said, hey, should we you know, change that error that's on our website, we would take the time to do it. But more often than not, Google, who is the most important audience of our website, cares that you have fresh and relevant content, meaning you are taking the time to update things, you're providing net new content, you are updating on a regular basis because they want people to feel like they're having an engaging experience on your site. It also gives Google a reason to come back to your site and re-index things and to see that you're actually taking the time to either push up blog posts or change pages. So ensuring that you're taking the time and you've got a plan or a calendar of, hey, we're going to do a weekly or monthly or every other month blog post or a new page on the site about this particular case study or something interesting a teacher is doing in one of our classrooms or something different that we're doing at the school, that's really important that you take the time to do it. It is certainly not a set it and forget it thing anymore. Technology, does the page load promptly? What's the average load time that people are expecting? Is this like 1.8 seconds and then
less than
2 seconds? And then about for every second after that, 20% of people will leave. Yeah. So if your site doesn't load in basically 5 seconds, regardless of the connection, you pretty much have lost everyone. They will go look for a competitor. They will not, it's just the way, you know, we are in a society where time is the most valuable human asset, and more we're communicating in, you know, 140 character tweets, but we also expect a really quick experience. So people want that site to be able to load as fast as possible. And then do all the things that you have on the site work, like the hyperlinks and the videos. Google and all the other search engines are able to tell if any of those features and functionality that you have on the site are broken. They are smart enough to know that these days. So you've got to fix the things that don't work, because they don't like to see sites that create a bad experience for the person that is on that website. I'm just looking at you in case you have anything to add about that. Yeah. Interactivity. Are there ways to engage the user, right? Rather than just sort of the text-based sites that, you know, we all built 10 or 15 years ago because that's what we were told to do. You know, society today, especially on the web, values pretty things. Like, for lack of a better way of saying this, you know, we've all been attracted to Instagram and attracted to Pinterest. People like pretty things on the web. So are you making it interactive? Are you including video content and image-based content on the website so that people have something to look beyond text itself? And the last thing is ease of use. Is it easy to navigate and understand the structure of the site? Have you taken the time to think about the structure of the site? What's our primary navigation? What are the pages that matter most? And then what are sort of the secondary or tertiary pages that come underneath? Google will go through that structure and understand, does it make sense? They have the ability to do that these days. If they don't feel like the structure of the site makes sense, that's something that they could potentially ding you for from a search results perspective. Great. Okay. So I mentioned that tool that can help you understand two things: how fast does your site load, and then also giving you some tips or tricks to make it even faster. This is that tool. It's called Google PageSpeed Insights. If you are looking for it, you literally need to Google PageSpeed, and it will be the first result that comes up, okay? What you do, in that little bar where it says enter your page URL, you put your website into that little box, you press analyze, and it's gonna give you two results. How fast, it's two scores, one for your desktop site, one for your mobile site, and it's a score out of 100. Anything below about like a 92, you've probably got some work to do to make the site faster. And some of those things are gonna be easy and some of those things are gonna be hard to execute. But it will give you a full report on both, like I said, the desktop and mobile site, and say, here are the things that you can do to improve the website. You might need to work with an external partner to make those things better, you might not. It might tell you, hey, you can do this, and that's something you can fix on the back end pretty quickly. So it just depends on what comes back with those results. But it's a really easy way to see just how fast your site is loading, one, and the score that Google feels like they give you based on the code that the site is developed in. Any questions on this tool? It's 100% free, by the way. You can use it as many times as you want. And you can also, as a school, if you're working with a third party, run this report and then send it to your agency or your development partner and be like, hey, you got to fix all these things because it's really bad. Go ahead. You go first and we'll come back to the gentleman. Yeah. Google's tool, so like Google's not looking at any other tools. There are other tools out there, but that don't look at specifics. And I'll also say it's not perfect. You know, there's been times where it'll tell you that this is a technical term. It'll be like minify the images, and when the images have been minimized as much as possible, right? So there are things that you may not be able to do. It certainly isn't perfect, but it's pretty well spot on. And yeah, the gentleman.
Yeah, you said that it gives you two scores on mobile. Web score,
does it further break down in terms of like what you really need to work on?
Yes. So it shows basically like a traffic light key, okay. Red being the major things that you really should work on, amber or orange being sort of the things that are not great but aren't causing a huge issue, and then green here are the things you're doing really well. Correct?
Yep.
Okay. Any other questions on this tool? Okay, no. I'm going to give it over to Scott.
So we'll look in the future. Now you've defined your brand. You have a unique value proposition for your organization. And you've built a good hub, your website. It's mobile friendly. Everything's going great. You now need to bring in some traffic to your website because you're trying to get some new enrollments or you want to increase donations or whatever purpose you've defined in your marketing plan. Search optimization is a great way to do it because it's free. So just like you go to Google and look for something, a lot of your prospective audience is going to do the same thing. How you come up towards the top of the list in Google is based on their algorithm that has a lot of different factors in it. I'm going to go through a few things in here that you can do to make a pretty big impact with minimal work and just kind of how to think about it conceptually. There's an unbelievable amount of resources online that you can find on how to do this, and you could pretty much go down the rabbit hole of spending a ton of time on it. But I want to cover the surface ones that I think are the most important just to give you really good perspective on kind of what this means and a few things you can do to impact it. You're trying to ultimately have a site that loads quickly, responds to mobile, and has a really good user experience. And that's something that Google cares a lot about, and it actually impacts your organic search rankings now, whereas it didn't in the past. So if your site does load slowly, like Michael referred to a few moments ago, you're going to get penalized. And if you don't have a good user experience, so if somebody comes to your site, for example, and they bounce really quickly off of your site, Google will start to look at that, and they're going to notice that there's not a good experience, so why would they want to drive traffic there? So you have to focus on that side of it, of creating an actually really relevant and good experience for the people that are coming to your site, and that's going to actually impact your organic search. But assuming you've done that well and you have fast, easy navigation that's good to use, you have a quick load time and the site is fully responsive, then you're ready to get started on this. I'll give you a quick example. So why this matters. So if somebody goes to Google and they do a search for Inspire Charter Schools, you'll see that it kind of looks like this. It comes up. They're taken to the website, and obviously if you have the correct experience on the website, then they'll perform the action that you want them to take. So in this case, maybe you want to get donations from them, or you want to get enrollment, or just have them find out more about it. Maybe the media is coming to your site because they want to publish a story that you did on the spectacular results you're having. So this is very important that you do this correctly so that you do come up with people who are looking for it. There's kind of two sides to organic search. So one of them is local, and the other one is sort of national. So if you think about local search, this is when somebody is looking for something nearby. So if you were looking for a restaurant, for example, you'd want to find restaurants that are near you because you're probably looking to go out and eat. Same thing would apply to a school. If somebody's looking for a school near them, which is probably the most predominant use case, you want to come up with that. One really good thing that you can do is get into Google Places and have it your profile optimized for your school. This is totally free. Google provides it, so you'll come up on maps and in searches that people do that are locally based. You can literally just Google and just type in Google Places or Google My Business and set up a profile and create it very easily. It doesn't take a lot of time, and once you have that done, you really don't need to update it too often, but you can go at any time you want and do an update on that. And Google does look at this as an indicator of relevance for searches that are done near you. So having that correct profile and having it set up, fully load all your pictures into it. Do a really good description in there, by the way, about your school. Keywords that you think people would care about in your description, because Google will look at all those as signals in their ranking.
The other thing is if you have a network of schools, there are tools out there that can help you manage this process, so it is not a manual. You're not doing this for every single school and having to log in and log out and create those logins. There are a variety of tools out there. If you've got 5, 10, 100, 500 schools across the country, that can help you manage these local listings, which are becoming vitally more important just because people are looking for things around you. If you think about the way search has changed over the last, let's say just the last 2 years, you're getting to a place that's very contextually different. It used to be, right, that a search was us typing in something into Google, whether it was on our desktop. We didn't use a lot of local terms, but when we're on the go, we're thinking more locally and geographically these days more than ever. So we're using terms like, charter school near me, and they're getting local results that are based on their actual location. You also got to think of the changing nature of the way people are actually interacting with their phones. more and more, a lot of those searches are being done by voice. So thinking about terms that people might use when they're talking to their phones, either into Siri or what's Google's, is it called Google Voice or what's their term?
Google Assistant.
Google Assistant now. Sorry, there's like, you know, they change these things every 14 days. But whether it's Siri or whether it's Assistant or whatever, voice is largely becoming a very dominant medium for us. A lot of us have got Alexa in our homes these days. Google's obviously done some products around voice and a lot of their home products around Assistant. And then we saw from the latest Apple developers conference that happened a week ago that Apple's bringing out a speaker in December that's going to be built all around Siri and search. So a lot more searches are becoming more vocally started. So that can change the context of how people search for things, whether it's schools or a product they're looking for. So consider those different opportunities as well.
So a couple tips to get you started in search. And these are not by any means the be-all and all the things that you can do, but this is kind of the, you know, if this were the 80-20 rule, this might be the 80%. So these are kind of the big things that you want to accomplish first. They're all pretty easy to do and they're free. So you just need to spend a little bit of time doing it. First thing you want to do is look for the right keywords. So if you think about the way that Google indexes your site, it's based on their understanding of what your site should come up for when somebody's searching. That's based on keywords. So what Michael talked about voice search, the same thing with non-voice search or when you type something into Google, they're going to look at that keyword phrase that you've typed in and try and match that to the best website. So accordingly, you want to have your site have those keywords on it so that Google will say, hey, this site is actually relevant for what this person is searching for. Usually you can start with 10 to 15 of these. You could have a lot more, obviously, but as you'll see when we kind of go through this, there's a bit of work that you have to do for each one, so you really don't want to go too many so that you water it down. You're looking for high search volumes in these, so there's some tools. You can just go into Google and type in organic keyword research tools, and you'll find a few of these that are available for free. They're all pretty good, and they tie into Google's API to pull the data. If you find ones that have a lot of search volume, those, then you're going to know that people are looking. What volume means is how many times somebody's searching for something every month. And Google reports those numbers. So you can actually figure out which keywords people are looking for so that you don't spend a lot of time optimizing for something that you think sounds great but doesn't have a lot of search volume. So that's the first thing, keywords that are relevant and that have people looking for them. If you want to get more in depth, this isn't on here, but you can compare that to competition. So then you kind of go to Google and you say, okay, for these keywords, how hard is it going to be for me to actually come up towards the top of the search results? Well, a really easy way to do that is just do the search for that keyword. See what sites are coming up at the top, and if there are ones like Wikipedia or other ones that are really relevant and you think are going to be hard for you to beat, then you may want to reconsider if you're going to choose that keyword, because you might be spending a lot of time on something to not end up getting the result you're looking for, which is having your site listed towards the top so you get the traffic for it.
Yeah, one thing that I've seen with some schools, they have actually looked at new enrolled students, spoken to their families, like asking them how they found out about the school. And 9 times out of 10, it starts with a search. So understanding what were you searching for. That's going to give you a really good idea as to what Scott was talking about in finding the relevant keywords. A lot of times schools will think, well, they're going to look for this and this and this and this, and you know, they have longer terms, like 4 or 5 words that someone's going to search for. And that's not actually how people search, right? So think about how you get onto Google and you're looking for a restaurant or you're looking for a store. I mean, that's how people are going to approach looking for something related to education or looking for the schools in their neighborhood. So asking new and newly enrolled families is a good way to get what some of those keywords might be.
I like what Kim said, because you really want to think from the perspective of the audience you're going after. So think about if you're a parent and you're going to find a charter school, what are you going to search? Well, you're going to look for best charter schools in probably the zip code, right, or the city name or something like that. So think about from their perspective, and that'll help you really pick the right keywords. Once you've chosen those, the best thing you can start to do is incorporate those into the content of your website, and you want to do it naturally. So back in the day in organic search, there were a lot of people would try and game the system, and they would do this by putting a ton of keywords into the content, just writing it over and over and over. People did a lot of crazy stuff, and they would put it, you know, links all over the place and really stuff it. Google got smart over time. They got some pretty smart folks over there, and those guys knew that people were trying to cheat the system. They said, hey, we're going to actually penalize you if you have the keyword in your site too many times. So they created this kind of index and basically calculate the amount of times that you use a keyword in your website. And you can't have too much, and you can't have too little, so you got to do it just right. And you're probably wondering, well, what's just right? So just right is does it read the way that a human would want to read it? So ask yourself that question when you put the keywords into your website. Write it to be informative and answer the question that somebody's looking for, but I'll have it read appropriately and correctly such that you could actually understand it and read it. You're not writing for a machine, you're writing for a person. And if it does work in that context, then you'll know that you've nailed that and you have it the right amount of times in there. The next step is really to create that content on your site. So what a lot of people think about content only as written content, there's a lot of different types of content. So clearly blog posts and having pages on your website with content are great content, but there's also a lot of other stuff. So you saw Michael's video at the beginning, video. Michael mentioned a couple stats on here that video is becoming really huge. Well, video content is a great thing that you can do for organic search as well. You can have videos posted on YouTube, embed them into your website. You can feature those on there. What about infographics? You design something that can be shared, and that actually gets it out and circulated around and syndicated in different channels so that people will ultimately find it, and maybe your school logo is on that because you produced it. Maybe it's something like top five things to consider when you're choosing a charter school. That would be a great and very informative and helpful piece of content to create. You also have typical content, blog posts, news articles, things like that, and page content on your website that is obviously good content and is the right type as well. But I want you to just keep an open mind that there's a lot of different channels that you can create content in. Once you've done this, so you have your website set up, it's really fast, it loads great, it's mobile friendly, fully responsive, and you now have it optimized, you need Google to know that you've done all this work. The best way to let them know is to actually tell them, and you create something called an XML sitemap, and you basically submit it to Google. And you tell them, this is where you're going to go, Google, to index my site, and this is going to be a listing of all the pages that are on my site, and the relative importance of all those pages. So you're helping them figure out what content to include, and making sure that they don't miss that content. This is totally free. Both Google has one, and Bing has one as well, which is Microsoft's search engine. The Bing one, just so you know, also powers Yahoo. So both of those two are you only have to go to one place and go to the Bing Webmaster Tools to submit it there, and then you can go to the Google one to do it for Google. It doesn't take much time and it's totally free. After you've done that, there's a couple things that matter with your rankings quite a bit. Beyond just content, one of those is links to your website. And Michael's gonna touch on social media in a little bit later, and social links are great ones where they're looked at as indicators of relevance. So Google looks at conversation that's happening around your brand, and they say, hey, if there's a lot of conversation and people are linking to this particular school and they're having a lot of thumbs up or they're sharing it a lot, those signals are impacting the actual results you get because Google says, hey, this is a relevant and timely topic or school that we should actually show very highly in our results. Another way to do it is to get links to your site. So this is kind of the original thing that Google actually created that differentiated their search engine from a lot of other ones and ultimately led to their success is their link formula. So they've looked at it, and they have a lot of different things, PageRank and whatnot that they look at, but really the biggest thing to think about is kind of like a popularity contest. Every time somebody links from their website and links to your website, that's like a vote. The more votes you get pointing to your website, Google says, hey, if there's 1,000 people that are all linking to this one site, it must be a pretty good site, right? So then they're going to actually bring that up higher and show it in their search results. So this is link building, and you need to do this and get as many of those links as you can from both social channels and from places like directories, education directories. There's lots of them, and they're free. So why wouldn't you want to get listed in there? Any .orgs or .edu sites that you can get actually have a lot of value, and those if you can get those to link back to you, that'd be great. And then think about partners. So if you partner with an organization that works with your school, ask them to link back to you. It's probably good for them, and it certainly is going to be good for you. So that would be an impactful way to do this as well. The second side of search. Oh, yeah, question.
Those like permanent links or the link on blogs also count?
Links on blogs do count, but just not as much as a permanent one. So they're both valuable.
Think of also from value of links as the source of that link as well. So links coming from newspaper websites, publications, depending upon if they're regional, local, or national, are also deemed relevant based and more authority, right, because they may have a larger presence. This is also how they weight links from people that are sharing content on social. So if someone that has 1 million followers shares a link to your website versus someone that has 100 followers, they will deem the person that has 1 million followers as more influential and give that link a higher score or a better weight, if you will.
There's something called Domain Authority that Google assigns. And it's basically a score, 0 to 100. And it's a score that measures their perception of the impact of a domain or a website. And the higher the number is in there, the more credibility that Google says you have. So if you get sites with like a 90 to link back to you, that's going to have more impact than a site with a 20 linking back to you. Because Google said, hey, that 90 site is really, you know, impactful. The ones that are above 90 are like, you know, Apple.com, things like that, that are pretty, you know, pretty big time, sort of hard to get. But you can certainly get ones in the 70s and 80s to link to you, and those would be great sources. And like Michael mentioned, social is incredibly important. Think about the relevance of the type of link too. So does it make sense for this organization to link to you, or does it not? And if it does make sense, that's going to have positive impact for you. And if it doesn't make sense, they might not help you as much, because Google's going to say, why are they even linking to you? It doesn't make any sense. So think about that. The second side of search, yeah, you have questions?
Two quick questions. One, sure. Does it matter where the content goes on the website, as in if it's a home page or, you know, a following page? And then the second question is, a lot of schools at this point have, every student has a laptop, and those laptops are being used at the school. Is there things that the school can do so when those students log on to the school's website, for instance, because there might be curriculum on there, that will help optimize that search engine? Or if it's the fact that they're all on the same network at the school, where Google kind of starts ignoring that and sees that as women.
Yeah.
So where the website, and then
they do look at the IP address of inbound traffic, and they're going to know that if all the same IPs are coming in here, that's probably one organization or an internal one.
Okay.
So that can play a role in it. The first part of your question with respect to what, you know, what page on the site does the content should it be at, there's two things to consider. So the home page is going to be your most important for the most part, but you also have things like blog pages that can be pretty important for very niche type keywords that are very specific. In your sitemap, like I talked about, when you submit it to Google, there's actually a way to prioritize the content that you have in there and assign a score to it. And Google doesn't have to comply with anything, but if you do this correctly, you can give them an indicator of what your perception is on the importance of certain pages on your website. So you could say, my homepage is the most important one, I'm going to assign it a 1. My blog pages are very important, but not quite as important, I'm going to assign them a 0.9. My, you know, info page or my about us page or something less important, I'll assign that a 0.3. So you're kind of giving them a measure of the importance of certain pages on your site. The way to pick what page the content should be on is just think about it from your site visitor's perspective. Where would you logically find this type of content? And as long as you're doing that, then you're pretty good.
What's the best way to utilize search engine optimization in multiple languages?
There's, do you have a lot of different searches for your school or something that are in different languages? There's a couple ways you can do it. So there's domain prefixes. So something like, let's say you wanted to optimize for and build an entire website for Mexico or for Canada or something. You could have like MX dot, you know, whatever your school name is. That'd be a subdomain or prefix that would allow you to have completely unique content for that particular language. The other way you can do it is have like a translation, you know, service that basically runs and translates the content. Google has one that they'll let you use. Google Translate, a lot of people have used it. You can put like little map flags basically to translate the content on your site. They're pretty smart now, so they'll know that you have that functionality, and they can kind of read the content in any language, and it'll be optimized for it. So I would say the best thing you can do is just make sure that it's available for your users in whatever language those people want. Google's gonna, they'll recognize it, they'll be able to index the content, and you'll be in good shape.
How do you use that domain authority to check?
How to use it? If you just go to Google, type in domain authority, there you'll find a tool that you can do that. You just type in the domain. So just like the thing that Michael had up there with page speed, it's like the exact same thing. And you'll there's a million different tools that do this. Moz is a really good one. I think it's probably one of the best. It's called M-O-Z. So just type in like Moz rank, and there's a tool on there that I like theirs because it's pretty comprehensive. It looks at Google's rating, but also a couple other factors too. And they're kind of considered sort of the, you know, one of the industry leaders in that area. Then you just look at the number. So if it's a high number for the result, that's the best you can get. It's a low number, you know, not as good. The paid side of search is called pay-per-click in the industry, and the reason it's called that is because when you look up here, that one that's highlighted there, every time somebody clicks on that, you're going to pay. So it works on an auction basis. In Google, that's how Google makes all their money. So every time somebody clicks on that listing that you've run for this paid search, you might pay $1 or $1.50 or $2 or something like that, whatever it is you're bidding to pay for that search phrase. So the good part about this, you can pick whatever keywords you want. So just like organic, you've done your research, you pick out the ones that you want people to come to your site for. Best charter schools in Chicago, Illinois, right? And you're going to come up right at the top there because you're willing to pay a lot for that keyword. Bad side, you got to pay for it. So it's expensive. Schools, you know, everybody's working on a shoestring budget, so it's not always readily available. You just have thousands of dollars to do this. So the organic part, it's all free. All the stuff I just talked about is completely free. This part, if you need results now, let's say you're doing a big fundraising campaign and you want people to come to your site right now because you want to do this, or enrollment is if you're in a huge enrollment push because you've got to hit these numbers before the August for the next class year. Well, you better get started on it, and organic's going to take a while. It can take 6 months, it can take a year for you to start to get some good results. So when time is of the essence and you have a very particular need, paid search is a really good way to do it. It looks like this. You can see that video on the right-hand side there, kind of what happens when somebody does a search. But the most important parts to know about this is an auction basis, you pick the amount that you're willing to spend on a keyword, and you pay every time somebody clicks on it. There is, of course, more complexity with this than that. Google has a formula that they use to determine which position the advertisers are going to come up in. The main point to take away from this is there's an inverse correlation between the amount you pay. That's called a click-through rate, and Google looks at that as an indicator of the success of your ad so that they can determine whether you have a better ad than somebody else, and ultimately you can pay less for your ad if you have a good ad. So you can either bid your way right to the top just by willing to pay more than everybody else, or you can be smart about it and pay less, but write better ads that are more relevant for particular keywords and still come up at the top of the list.
That's a good question. Scott's the search expert, but I want to ask a question. If you remember, the search ads used to be like big blue, bold, yellow background, and now they've like gotten basically rid of that, and it's very hard to decipher paid versus organic. Has there been any studies on the fact that people don't really care where it's coming up these days, and if it's first, it's first? Because it used to be people would trust organic rankings over paid ads.
There's the traffic tends to be pretty split, like almost around half of people will click on the paid ads and half will click on the organic ones. It really depends on who's advertising and how good the ads are and all that. To their particular numbers, it could be 70-30 in either direction. But that's probably the most extreme you're going to have it. The question is a really good one, though. Google has done a ton of testing on this, and they want to maximize the amount of money that they get. That's their job. And they have the smartest people in the world doing tests on this all the time to figure out the best way to show it. Right now, they just have a little ad symbol in there, and it is kind of difficult to tell the differences between the paid ones at the top and the organic ones. That's probably somewhat intentional, right? Because they want people clicking on those. That's how they make all their money. I think 90% of all of the money that Google makes, which I think they do around $90 billion a year, so about $80 billion worth of revenue comes in from people clicking on those ads. So they're trying to intentionally provide a good experience, but also make it pretty similar to the organic ones. Recently, as a really fun note for any search nerds out there, they've gotten rid of the ones on the right-hand side. So they only have the ones in the top now. If you remember before, they used to have ads on the right and the top. Well, they actually found out that contrary to what you would think from logical deduction, they get more clicks now without more ads. So there's less ads showing on the page now. You only have up to 3 or 4 on the top at the most. And then it's all organic ones until the bottom. And they're actually doing better. So, which also at the same time is a pretty positive thing for us as people that use our search engine, because it's a lot easier and it looks less spammy with all those ads on the side.
Does that mean that schools should be investing in both then?
If you have the budget, like I said, and there's an urgent need, then I would definitely would invest in both. You can really accomplish a lot through paid search. It's also a lot more trackable than organic is in many ways, because you can do things very specific, like track through when somebody clicks on your ad to a donation page or to an application form and see that they actually came from a single keyword and converted to whatever action you're trying to take. You can't do that very easily with organic. You can deduce it by setting up stuff in analytics, but it's a lot more difficult than it is with paid search. So there's a lot of value there.
One thing to think about when you're looking at these types of campaigns for paid search, let's talk about student enrollment for a second. When you launch a campaign we'll use Google, and your ad is specific for student enrollment, you're only going to pay based on those folks who actually click on the ad, right? So you are not paying to have the ad there. You're paying when someone clicks on the ad. So someone who clicks on that ad is already motivated because they're interested in what you have to offer. So they are somewhat already qualified because they're looking for that information. So having that pay-per-click ad linked to a landing page or form, in this case for student enrollment, that's actually going to benefit you because it's already someone who is looking for that information. So when you're trying to compare doing something, and I'm going to stick with the student enrollment example, paid search versus doing an ad in your community newspaper where you're going to have to pay for the creative, you're going to have to pay for the media insertion, you're going to have to run it multiple times because one print ad isn't going to get you nearly anything, and you can't track the print ad. This is very trackable. You got to compare those type of things because, again, here, you're not paying unless somebody's actually clicking on the ad.
Questions, sure. In the front here.
So do you think, particularly, I thought there were a lot of independent operators up here. Do you think that an independent operator can do the pay-per-click effectively without an outside expert?
I mean, it's not easy, to tell you the truth. So it can get away from you pretty quick. I've seen this happen too many times, unfortunately, where you have a staff member that just feels like experimenting and puts in the credit card, and all of a sudden, like, you get a $1,000 bill, right? And you didn't get a lot for it. So I definitely recommend that you have somebody that knows what they're doing. Whether they're internal or external is really up to, whether your organization wants to staff for that type of thing or whether you just want to outsource it. There's a ton of experts out there in the world that are great at this. Just make sure you have one of them doing it, because otherwise you'll spend a ton of money and you won't get a lot of results.
And I would say, I would add on to that, the testing, if you're an independent school and you haven't done paid search before, try it, set some parameters, set the budget for the campaign so it's low, so you're not going to get a huge bill, and test it on one thing and see what happens. I mean, it's really, this is something that is agile. Like, you can start a campaign, and if you're seeing that you're not getting any results, you can stop it.
Yeah, that's
nice. I was going to add two things to that question. If you're looking for an outside resource, Google has certifications that prove that this person knows knows what they're doing. Scott's agency being one of them, but there's a Google Cert AdWords expert certification. Then there's one that's for an entire group or agency that they get for having a certain number of people meet a threshold. And then Google has what's called a premier agency partnership, right? Which only a certain number of agencies qualify for in the country and in the world, Scott's agency being one of them. That's one thing you want to look for. Do they have the certification so they've got the knowledge? And two, do they work in the education space? Because it means they'll have access to resources and knowledge that maybe if they were a retail-focused or restaurant-focused search marketing group, that they may not get the space. So understand that. The other thing that I'll tell you as it relates to budget is there could be times during certain times of year where the cost of paying the agency is more than the cost of the media that you're spending. So you may be only spending $200 to $300 on actual budget that you're sending to Google, but it's $1,500 or $2,000 or $5,000 for the management of those campaigns. You have to be able to differentiate that the agency has time and materials that go into managing those campaigns, even though your media budgets may be vastly smaller than the amount of time that it takes to manage them. Those are things you have to differentiate. It's not like a newspaper ad where you pay a flat fee and you understand, like, that's the value that I'm getting. There is a media spend, and then there's an agency spend or a partner spend, and sometimes it is more expensive than the media that's actually being placed. You're paying for the smarts of the people that know how to place it effectively and hopefully get you the best results. Question.
Based on what you've seen from successful startups, is there a rule of thumb on how much your budget should be allocated to marketing?
We've seen schools be at 1%, I've seen schools be at 5%, and I've seen a school be at 15%. It just depends on how they're focused and what efforts that they're doing, and what particular phase of their growth that they're in.
Yeah, I'd say that a good average, if you're looking at your total budget for the school, if you're in a startup phase and you're allocating somewhere between 2% and 5% to start, and you set some really, really good metrics in terms of what you're trying to measure, you can always move up from there. We have startup schools that we've worked with, though, that have a higher percentage they allocate to marketing because they have to enroll students. And if you don't have any students, your school's not going to survive. So that's something to think about in that stage. And then as the school grows, when you're getting into that replication phase, the budgets tend to be a lot higher.
Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to fly through the last slides and leave 5 minutes for questions, so just hold your questions so we get through the material. Okay, social media. We'll make this fast, quick, and dirty. Okay. You've set your platform, now you have to tell your story. Why does social matter? Because more than ever, this is where people are going to get their info on what their friends are recommending, where they're spending their time, how brands are telling their stories, whether it's Instagram, Facebook, and the like. All of these platforms are built around a visual perspective, right? No matter where you look from social, it's largely being built around visual assets. Video, images, boomerangs, GIFs, memes, things of that nature. That's the type of content that people are sharing these days. That's the type of content you need to be producing because we are largely moving to a very visual web. If you're considering where should I be these days, I will tell you this. This is how it breaks down in terms of by the numbers, and I'm showing you Facebook because that's the behemoth in the room and that is the end game these days. Twitter, we're not seeing a lot of user growth in Twitter. Now that Instagram has rolled out a bunch of new features like stories and has basically copied everything that Snapchat has done, you're seeing growth slow down at Snapchat as well. They actually took a huge hit on their quarterly results because they're not seeing growth now that Instagram's basically copied everything that they've done. Boo-hoo, ha-ha, but I don't care. But anyway, Facebook is the name of the game right now when we're talking about where people are spending their time. So we're talking about Facebook.com, right? Facebook pages. We're also talking about the ecosystem of Facebook, that being Instagram, which is also owned by Facebook, WhatsApp, and Messenger, where you're starting to see Facebook actually provide opportunities for brands to get into Messenger and WhatsApp by paying for when somebody's looking for something or placing orders or getting to know a specific brand. It will not be surprising, I think, within the next couple of years where you'll see your school have a Facebook Messenger icon on their website and you can conversate with someone, maybe it's a prospective student or maybe it's a prospective parent. And it's going to cost money to be able to do that because that is where people are going to be spending their time. So that's sort of where we are in terms of by the numbers. That being said, don't forget to, number one, test new platforms, the sort of sexy new tools that are out there to see if you have traction. And don't forget about the old ones, too. So some things to think about when it comes to, quote unquote, new platforms. Snapchat is certainly one, but it remains to be seen if Snapchat is going to be around over the next few years. And I would probably put Twitter into that bucket as well. We don't see schools leverage Twitter very well. It isn't an audience where we see a lot of educational related content. That being said, it's a good place for teachers to be because they can find teachers sharing content that's great resources for them doing professional learning, but for schools and attracting students and parents, it's probably not the best place for you. LinkedIn, older platform, right, but maybe a place where you can build some thought leadership, get to know board members, get to know people that can be advocates, political, you know, things. Political or organizations or cities have good presences on LinkedIn that you can try and build partnerships as well. The one that the screenshot you see here on the right is Great Schools. Don't forget that when we say social, we're not just talking about the actual networks like Facebook and Instagram, but there's the review sites, right? GreatSchools.com being one of them. If you're not familiar with Great Schools, these are basically directories, places where parents and students can go to search, and it's like the Yelp of schools. So people can rate the school and tell them how good of a bad experience it is. I will tell you this, you're going to want to be monitoring that the online reputation of your school, right? What are people sharing on Yelp? What are people sharing on Great School? What are people sharing on Google reviews? Here's what we know. What the research suggests is if you ignore bad reviews, you actually look worse than if you actually engage those individuals. And it's a 3-to-1 rule. You engage 3 times and then you get out of the conversation. So if someone's just a complete heretic and just wants to destroy the reputation of your school, they're going to do it regardless. You interact with them 3 times online, and then you either take the conversation offline or you move on with life and just chalk it up to a loss. But ignoring bad reviews is worse than at least not engaging with them. What the research shows us, and when you look across the board, is when you actually engage, even with a bad review, it looks better for the people that'll come back and see those reviews that you took the time to engage than simply ignore. So, key points there. Keep in mind that social is much more than just these social networking sites like Facebook, Twitter, and the like. You've also got to consider your online reviews and things of that nature.
So one thing to add to social media, for those of you who have not captured your school's name on some of these platforms, that is the first thing that you should do when you get back after this conference.
So even if you're not going to be, even if your school is, or your school principal or your school leader is not going to be on Snapchat or whatever newfangled.com comes out tomorrow, go get your username. Okay, because the worst thing that can happen is a student gets a hold of that username or somebody that doesn't like gets a hold of that username, and then you've got a reputation issue that you have to get into with one of these platforms. And just as a school, you're not paying them, you're not Pepsi who's giving them millions of dollars in ads. They're not going to pay attention to you when you have a copyright or a trademark issue. It's going to take months to get rid of those things. So even if you don't think you're going to be on Snapchat, just go get the username. Even if you don't think you're going to get me on Instagram, just go get the username and make the profile private so that you own that username around your brand. Good point. Okay, that's social. We could have a whole session on social. I think there actually is, but we're moving on to a different channel now. Email marketing. Tried and true, email's been around since 1996. It continues to be a place where people are paying attention. Why? Well, we're all being bombarded by all these crazy social networks, and we're spending all of our time in these social networks. But what we've seen is that as we've seen the proliferation of these networks and people spend more time, email engagement has gone up. And what we think is probably happening is that email is kind of like the old tried and true place that we all kind of understand, even though we hate it. We hate the volume of email that we get. We hate how we feel like we get bombarded by that on a daily basis from brands. But it's a place we understand and control. Everyone knows how to reply. Everyone knows how to forward. Everyone knows how to reply to all. We know how to create our folders and create rules of what goes in that folders, right? So we see a lot of engagements increase as it relates to email, particularly for education, but a ton of other industries in the last 2 or 3 years. And that's largely because we are connected to these things day in and day out. People read email on the go. They read the email when they're on the toilet. They read the email on their vacation. You read email everywhere, right? That's just, we know these stats, right? This is a place where you can create really easy segments for audiences. Emails that go out to parents, emails that go out to advocates, emails that go out to government relations or audiences that are related to those types of topics. So you can tell your story in a really unique way. The other thing to keep in mind about as you're thinking about tips as it relates to email, a couple of things to keep in mind. As I mentioned, we're largely reading email in this context rather than being connected to a desktop. So more than ever, people are reading email on their smartphones. Make sure that you're taking advantage of that. Keep the emails mobile friendly, and I'll show you how to do that in a second. If you can, let the images do the talking. Again, we appreciate a pretty web. If you've got something to say that you can say visually, do it with an image over text. Copy and text should always be greater than 15-point font because these screens are tiny and our eyes are getting worse. And make sure you're following spam compliance. In the United States, the spam compliance is this. You can send one email to every email address one time. It is the second time you send a promotional campaign that you have to get an opt-in. Somebody has to say, yes, I'm okay with you sending me email. So some things to keep in mind. Mobile friendly means single column or skinny layouts because Facebook's taught us all to do this with our thumb. That's what people like to do with their inbox. We use our thumbs. So anything that people need to consume in an email needs to be thumbable, if you will. They can scroll through your email, they can tap on it. Make sure you've got, you know, nice calls to action, big images. This is an example from Tommy John, which is a men's underwear line and undershirt line, right? Nice big images. You can see the product features, nice big buttons. This is the Kennedy Center. You know, single column where people can scroll through all the content and get through that email campaign. Some fonts and buttons, these are the best practices. Headlines need to be a minimum of 30 pixels. Body copy is 16. And if you do anything below that, Apple is going to re-render that at a size of at least 13 pixels. So if your emails look funky or weird on your iPhones, it's because they're not big enough. Apple just re-renders the font because they know that's the smallest font that someone can read when they're holding the phone at the average human arm length away. Buttons need to be at least 44 by 44 points. Why? Because all of our big fingers these days need an adequate space. Why that size? Because Apple knows and has looked at billions and billions of interactions and said that is the size of the average humanable finger tappable area. 44 points by 44 points with a little bit of white space behind it. Those of us with fat fingers like myself, we get really annoyed if you don't put some white space in to make the buttons big enough because we start to tap multiple things that we weren't trying to tap. This can also be free for schools as well, but there's also platforms that you can pay for. One of those that's free and I think the best, this is just my personal recommendation, is MailChimp. Why? Because they give you if you have under 5,000 subscribers, it's a free account for you to utilize. You can create forms that are embedded on your website so that people can opt in. You can integrate with third-party tools like your attendance system to pull in that data automatically. And MailChimp is getting better every single day, and they're not making people pay for those net new features that they're rolling out. They're just adding it to their accounts regardless if you're paying for it or if you're on the free account. And it has the best-in-class deliverability. All of this work around email is for naught if you don't get into the inbox, right? Video, I'm going to literally screen through this section, but this is probably the most fun part of this presentation. As I mentioned before, 80% of what people will consume by 2020 will be video on their phones. So we need to be able to tell our stories as schools through visual platforms, these being short form, long form, and potential animated options. So these are some things you can think about. High production value. I'm not saying you have to spend things like the dollars that were spent on this, but you have a couple options when it comes to video, high production value being one of them. This comes from Success Academy in New York, of course, who's a won countless awards, but they've told their story in really unique ways. It's actually really cute. I don't know why it's not playing, but suffice it to say, super cute video that tells the story of why kids find success to be the place for them. Now, this is a 2.5 minute video that really encapsulates what success is about, right? They've paid for probably a videographer. This is probably a $20,000 to $50,000 endeavor. But what they get out of this is really great content that can be shared not only on YouTube, not only on their website, but on Instagram and all these places. So if you're gonna spend the dollars on creating these assets, you can do really good high production values, but you don't have to. You can do things like this, an animated or a sketch version. This comes from great schools. You know, doing like, what's the reason to pick a charter school in your local market? Why pick us in Cleveland, or why is our school better? And sort of animate those things. These can be a little less expensive. You can work with college students to produce these things and roll them out pretty easily. Short video is also something that you're gonna wanna pay attention to, right? People have really short attention spans these days. That's why Snapchat and Instagram stories and the like have really grown so much over the last few months. Another great example, again, is Success Academy. They've been educating people about net new features. So this was on their Instagram profile yesterday. They're showing off the new features for Instagram, showing their audience how they can use these things. They're educating on the platforms themselves because they know that they want their parents to be able to tell their stories of success as well. And they're just showing off different ways to use the platform. And then you'll see in a few seconds, they show off a lot of the videos that they're doing inside the school. So you can see they're like doing boomerangs and slow-mo videos of what their students are doing inside on any given day inside the classroom. Just some really great examples of little stories that they're telling. This is using the boomerang app, right? You know, that has 1,207 views in less than a week. You know, probably more impact than, you know, your display ad or your search ad will have. So short video can be a really compelling way to tell your story as a brand. Okay, resources that you can use. Embedded into this presentation is areas where you can go to continue to learn about any of the topics that we've talked about today, whether it's search, your website, email, or social media. These are all linked in the presentation, so feel free to click on those. And then just some final thoughts that we want to leave you with. First of all, make sure that any of the digital tactics that you're doing support your overall marketing strategy, right? So if you're trying to drive enrollment, the tactics that you're doing from a digital perspective should support that overall strategy. Like we've mentioned before, execution can be internal or external, but be aware of the potential pitfalls that can happen with working with internal partners that may not know what they're doing and could have issues with spending or not understanding what's happening on these platforms. Look for advocates in your community that can help tell your story, right? So all of these things that you're putting online, these content pieces, are for naught if they don't get talked about. Look for parents that may have a few thousand or a few million Instagram or Twitter followers. You may be surprised at some of the parents that you've got in and around your school that can help tell your story. And don't reinvent the wheel. You're not trying to, do the latest and greatest things. Tackle one thing and see the impact that it has on your school. You don't need to go out and tomorrow. We're not suggesting that you're doing search ads and you're on Instagram and you're on Snapchat and you're on Facebook. Pick off the places where you think your audience is spending their time, build a presence there, see what works, test, iterate, look at those results, and see what's driving traction for your school. Different tactics require different things, right? This is a time and resources material. You're gonna spend money on potentially hard costs and soft costs, and that's all things you're gonna have to look at, right? How much time does our team need? How much dollars do our team need as well? And just remember that these are things, a lot of these tactics you can increase. So you can start with a very small budget for search or a very small budget for email or social and increase that budget depending upon how successful that specific tactic is or not. And that's it. As I mentioned before, all of our email addresses are there, all of our phone numbers are there. That's actually both Kim and my cell phone. It's not my cell phone, it's my cell phone. So if you have any questions, feel free to shoot us a text, an email, and or give us a ring. If you've got questions, we're happy to answer them.
What's your main website
again? I'll go back so you can take a screenshot of that.
It's charterschoolcapital.org/national.
Right there.
And you said you can download the slides from that?
Yep.
Yes. Yep.
Yep.
So, going back to engaging on negative reviews, in your best opinion, is it best to ask third-party supporters or possibly your parents to engage on those issues as opposed to the school as an organization, or is it best to start to engage as the school?
I would do a hybrid model, but be very careful that you set the expectation of what you're asking parents to do. and be very careful that there's not an orchestrated effort to do, you know, to go after individuals and create even more damage, because it can be looked at as a very much like a mob mentality if you're attacking that individual on numerous fronts. So just be very careful of how you engage parents and or teachers or advocates that go after and review those people. What I would say is it would be better to ask those types of individuals to write positive reviews versus attack the negative reviews that maybe be there. Leave the negative responses and how you're going to engage them to just the school itself and handling those. Engage those individuals up to 3 times. If they're still causing chaos, either ask for the conversation to be taken offline or ignore, because at that point it's not worth engaging them past the 3. The slide slides are right here. charterschoolcapital.org/national is where you'll find the slides. That URL right there.
Yeah. What about audience behavior targeting? So paid ads for when they go to particular sites that are relevant to what you're doing.
So we're talking about like custom audiences, lookalike audiences on Facebook. What are you talking about?
Well, so like let's say whoever's using it fits a particular demographic, and they go to a site that's similar to yours, and there's paid ads on that site.
Okay.
All right. I mean, how do you folks feel about putting ads on there?
You can do. They're all going to have low click-through rates. They're going to have banner or display advertising click-through rates historically, which are under 1%.
Okay.
I think they're useless. I don't think people actually look at banner ads. I think they find them annoying, or they click on them accidentally more often than not. They're a great brand awareness tool, but they're certainly not a great direct response if you're trying to drive student enrollment. If you're trying to drive eyeballs, probably not the greatest conversion for driving those opportunities. But if you want to be able to take over, you know, the local newspaper publication's website for the sake of saying, like, we support this publication, then yeah, great brand awareness tool, but beyond that, I don't think they're beneficial. Yeah. We'll take more questions up front if you have them. Feel free to come up. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm glad you got a phone.